The Lord preserveth the simple. I was brought low, and he helped me. Return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord hath dealt bountifully with thee. What shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. Let us unite in prayer. Our gracious God, the words we have read and thought upon are applicable to ourselves, for we also have been brought low, and thou hast helped us, and we come into thy presence to give thanks, to pay vows, to declare how good the Lord is, and how much we love the Lord and would serve him. Give us grace now in drawing near to thee, that sin may be pardoned and our souls may be moved, and we may with great sincerity and uprightness of heart call upon thy name. Be heard of us, we pray. Incline thine ear unto our prayers and also to our praises. And may it please thee to accept what we offer as spiritual offerings acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. All our trust and reliance is upon thy Son, our Saviour. We plead his life for blessing. We plead his death for pardon. We plead the worthiness of his name for communion and for fellowship with God. Look upon us as thy Son's people and turn aside to us to be with us, to dwell with us this night. Come with mercy to us, for we need that. On account of our sins, come with grace, for we need that on account of our barrenness and our emptiness. Therefore, come to meet our need. Send us later on our way with a glad heart and with a blessed soul. And we pray that blessing given today may be with us for a long season, for many days to come. Bless thy church everywhere, and what we seek for ourselves, we seek for the people of God, and we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. We sing together from Psalm 118. Psalm 118. The tune is Southwark, which is 1, 2, 3 in the Red Psalter. Psalm 118, and we're singing verses 1 to 9. Oh, praise the Lord, for he is good. His mercy lasteth ever. Let those of Israel now say, his mercy faileth never. 118, 1 to 9.
Oh, praise the Lord. Now let the house obey.
Our Old Testament reading tonight is in the book of Psalms, Psalm 82. The Psalm 82, a psalm for Asaph. God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judgeth among the gods. How long will ye judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? Selah. Defend the poor and the fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and needy. Deliver the poor and needy. Rid them out of the hand of the wicked. They know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. I have said, ye are gods, and all of you are the children of the Most High, but ye shall die like men and fall like one of the princes. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. That short psalm really consists of two parts. In the first part of the psalm, from verse 1 to verse 5, there is a description of the unrighteous judgment of men. The mighty spoken of here in verse 1, and the gods refer to those that are exalted in society, whose business it is to represent God and to see that his will is done. They are men, but they are raised as gods. They represent God, and they defend God's interests. Who are they? Well, verse 2 gives us a clue, perhaps a key even. How long will ye judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? Asaph is referring to human judges in the land. And he says that their judgment is not according to justice. Evil, wickedness prevails amongst them, so that they judge unjustly and they reward the wicked. And they don't do what they should do, defend the poor and the fatherless and do justice to the afflicted and the needy. It's a sad state of affairs in any nation when righteousness is lost sight of, justice is ignored, and men call evil good and good evil. So in these first five verses, we have the willful and determined sin of those in authority and those over the people. They know not, neither do they understand. They walk on. No repentance, no return to God. They walk on in darkness. And as a result of that, the foundations of the earth, the principles of justice and righteousness in the land are shaken, dislodged, and threatened. The unrighteous judgment of men. But then, from verse 6, the righteous judgment of God. I have said, ye are gods, And all of you are children of the Most High. They were God's because they stood in God's place. But ye shall die like men, fall like one of the princes. There is somebody above the judges, somebody whose authority and power is greater by far than theirs. Arise, O God, verse 8, the supreme judge, the judge exalted upon the throne of heaven, the God before whom all humanity is gathered. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. And because of the injustice of these judges, the psalmist calls upon God to take the situation in hand, to restore right in high places, and intervene directly among the affairs of men. Not difficult to see how such a situation prevails today. We have sin being legislated and put upon our statute books as law, and we have right things being declared wrong, and things which are unacceptable to men but acceptable to God. It seems as if the whole balance of justice has been disturbed. But God is above. He witnesses all. He's able to interpose. He's able to redress the situation. He's able to deal with evil. He's able to exalt righteousness again and restore the nation, restore the church. True, at the moment he seems not to be acting, but such is the prevailing prayer of the last verse, Arise, O God. Put the matter to right, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. And with that understanding, I hope received, we can now sing this psalm, Psalm 82. The tune is St. Thomas, which is 119. And as we turn to that passage, you may well remember that our Lord referred to such a passage as we have read in John chapter 10, when he was accused of blasphemy, and his defense against the Jews who accused him was that he called himself the Son of God, but there were men in the Old Testament called gods because they stood in God's place. So we sing now from Psalm 82, the whole of the psalm, to the tune St. Thomas 119, God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. In God's assembly, God doth stand. He judgeth gods among. How long, accepting persons vile, will ye give judgment wrong? Psalm 82.
In God's assembly, God doth stand. He judgeth gods among. How long accepting persons vile will he give judgment?
this evening in the New Testament. We begin reading the Epistle to the Galatians. Galatians chapter 1. Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren which are with me, unto the churches of Galatia. Grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. And ye have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the tradition of my fathers. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb, and called me by his grace to reveal his Son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. Neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. Then after 3 years I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. And other of the apostles saw I none, save James the Lord's brother. Now the things which I write unto you, behold, before God I lie not. Afterwards I came into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and was unknown by face unto the churches of Judea which were in Christ. But they had heard only that he which persecuted us in times past now preacheth the faith which once he destroyed. And they glorified God in me. Paul is writing to the southern section of the Roman province of Galatia. The time is somewhere about AD 48, 49. He's been there to preach in that period. Now it's a little later than that, actually. Several years have passed. And he looks back to his visit in the late 40s, and he sees that things have declined, trouble has come into the church, particularly in the form of false teaching. And men have tried to mix traditional Judaism with Christianity, and it's become a kind of works religion all over again. And Paul says, they have succumbed to another gospel, a perverted gospel, and he's obviously deeply concerned for them. In the opening four verses, there's a salutation, which is usual in these epistles. And then the Galatian problem is revealed in verses 6 to 10. Paul declares that the Galatians have lapsed, and they've given up the gospel which he first preached to them, and they've taken up a very poor, despicable substitute for that. And so in 6 to 10, he makes known his concern. And then in 11 to 24, he declares that he is an apostle of Jesus Christ directly, and the message which he preached to them at the first was not from men and did not depend upon men, but was received from Jesus Christ. So he received apostleship, and he received the Christian message straight from Christ. The conclusion which he's going to draw is this, that these people who say that they're apostles are no apostles at all. And the message they preach is not a message from the Son of God at all. And therefore it must fall before the authentic message of Paul, who saw the Lord and to whom the Lord spake on the Damascus Road and later. That message does not change. It is not to be adapted. It is the same in every age. And therefore, there's no excuse for the Galatians turning to something newly fashioned like this Judaized gospel. It's not true. It's not what the Lord revealed. It's not what Paul was given to preach. And therefore, he makes known in chapter 1 that it is highly suspect. Indeed, it is erroneous. The nature of that will be their gospel that they are preaching will be revealed as we enter chapter 2. And Paul is at great pains to defend justification by faith alone, that we're only right with God by trusting in God's Son. They were teaching that that is only part of the truth. Our full justification comes when we not only trust Christ, but when we obey the law of Moses. So they were compromising the leading tenet and the leading doctrine of the gospel. And Paul will move in the chapters which follow to defend what became the watchword of the Reformation, the great key to that great movement in the 16th century, the just shall live by faith, and by faith alone. Well, now we'll turn to prayer. Let us stand for prayer. Our gracious God, we thank thee for the message which has been brought to us and has been recorded and preserved in Holy Scripture. By these means, we know that it is the true message which was preached from the beginning and which the church has received through the years of time. We thank thee for the wonderful truth that is at the heart of the gospel and the Christian message, that we are right with God not by what we do, but by what Christ has done. And whereas the law comes to us and it says, do, 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 and commits us to a works religion, the gospel comes to us and says, done. It's all been done by the Son of God, and there is nothing more to do, only to receive what he has done and to rest on that for everlasting life. We pray for the blessing of God to be upon that gospel tonight. It's precious. It's the word of God. It's settled in heaven. It endures to all generations, and we pray that grace may be with it tonight. The Spirit of God may hover over the preaching of it. We pray that thou wouldst use it to convict men of wrongdoing and bring men to saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We think of the early preaching, that it was not in word only, but in demonstration of the Spirit and with power. We ask that ministers may preach tonight, demonstrating that the Spirit of God is with them, and powerfully declaring the word of God, that hearts will be opened, eyes will be enlightened, and souls will be saved. We pray a blessing upon it in this land, that in a place where there is so much that is false and untrue, the word of God may have free course tonight and be glorified. We pray for it on the mission field and amongst the peoples of this world, and pray that the word of God may be preached powerfully, and we pray that the strongholds of unbelief will collapse before the word of God, and that sinners will be brought to surrender and to yield to the Savior whose gospel it is. So bless it, we pray, in all the earth, and may it be a saving blessing tonight. Again, we remember ourselves and our many needs here in the church. We think again of our brother Peter Bravery as he faces this major surgery on Tuesday. We pray thee to keep his heart in peace, that he may be trusting in the Lord, that thou wouldst hear his prayers, the prayers of his family, and the prayers of the church, and bring him safely through this time. Grant that the operation may prove to be a success, and that very soon he will be back with us again. We pray for our friend Bob Rutherford, who's to have an operation this week, and we pray that that also may go well, and that thou wouldst keep him during these days before the operation, looking to the Lord and seeking his favor to be upon him. And we join with him and with Carol and all the family and pray that this operation may go well, and that the problem may soon be eased and indeed removed, and that good quality of life will be restored, and that the future will prove how beneficial this operation has been, just how successful it has been. We thank thee that in all of the trials of life and the challenges of life, we have a Savior to whom we can turn, one who walks with us and talks with us along life's narrow way. We pray that each of us, whatever we face, that we may be hand in hand with the Lord Jesus Christ, and that we may know his friendship greater than ever, friendship that no trial or trouble can fracture or break, friendship which is everlasting. And so be with us all, and be with those that are unwell, those that are elderly, incapable of coming to the house of God. Be their rock, be their support, be their hope. And we pray that they may know tonight that we remember them, and best of all, that God remembers them. So hear us in these our prayers. Forgive our many sins. Help us to heed the word which we heard this morning, that our walk may be regular in this world, that we may be consistent as Christians on our way to heaven, and that others may see our life has changed for the good, and that the Lord our God is with us. So bless our testimony to them, and may our witness be effective, and may it move them to inquire after our God, and not to take rest until they discover the Lord Jesus Christ for themselves. So help us to mind our testimony in this world, to make sure that we do not let thee down or disappoint thee in any way, but that we might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, is all our desire and all our prayer. We give thee thanks again tonight for thy goodness to this church and for the way in which this great sum of money has been given to this cause. And we pray thy blessing upon the Grove House project. And we pray that as the plans are revealed and as the work is done, so we may see God leading us into his perfect will. And in the future, we may look back and see how God has done all things well, that step by step, he has guided us and he has fulfilled his own plan and purpose. And we pray that it may be to the good of many churches and to the good of the cause of the Lord Jesus Christ in our land. Use Grove House for thy glory, and grant that men may be trained there and equipped to preach the everlasting gospel and to lead thy people in these difficult and trying times, to be faithful pastors of them, to lead them in obedience to thy word, to preach the whole counsel of God, to nurture them as pastors, to look after them and care for them in all their need. We pray thee to raise up many such pastors in the churches, and we ask that the church may be greatly comforted and strengthened as a result of these prayers answered. So hear now our prayers, be with us from this moment on, and open to us thy holy word in a few moments, and help us to understand the truth and make it a blessing to us, for Christ's sake. Amen. We sing from Psalm 119, and it's the sixth part, beginning at verse 41, to the tune set, which is Kilmarnock 75. Let thy sweet mercies also come and visit me, O Lord, even thy benign salvation, according to thy word. The sixth part of Psalm 119, to the tune.
Let thy sweet mercies, O Lord, so shall I
Tonight we read from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, and a very familiar parable of Christ. We read from verse 9. He spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up into the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For every one that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Now this is a very well-known parable. A parable being a figurative way of speaking, but one which teaches a spiritual and a moral truth. I suppose it could be said that this parable answers the question, how can a man approach unto God? In the Pharisee, we see the way not to draw near to God. In the publican, we have the right way to come to him. Or it even could be that the question which arises is, how can a man be saved? Saved from the consequences of sin, saved from the awfulness of divine judgment. He can't be saved by relying upon his works like the Pharisee. He can be saved by trusting in the mercy of God like the publican. So this parable is a fascinating one because it's very direct. It deals with the great issue of life. How can I come to God? Or perhaps more plainly, how can I be saved? Now, the two men in the parable, the one a Pharisee, the other a publican, there are certain things true of them both. The first is that they both felt the need of God. The second is that they both observed appointed time and appointed place. At the hour of prayer, they appeared, and into the temple they both went. And both wanted one particular benefit. They wanted to be in a state of being right with God. At the end of the parable, when Christ is giving his own summing up, he says that the publican was justified, verse 14, and not the Pharisee. Now, justified is a very technical word in the New Testament, which we won't go into tonight. Basically, it means to have a right standing with God, or to be right with God. The Pharisee returned to his house. He was still not right with God. The publican returned to his house, and he was right with God. I want us to look just for a moment at the two persons around which the parable revolves. First of all, the Pharisee. Two men went up into the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee. The word Pharisee comes from a word which means separation. A Pharisee is a separated one. We don't exactly know when the Pharisees began. They seem to have emerged from the class of the scribes that are often mentioned in the New Testament and mentioned also in the Old Testament. These men were men of Scripture. In many ways, they were perfectly orthodox. They believed the great doctrines of the faith, but they laid tremendous emphasis upon the Torah, or the law of God. And one of their leading teachings was that in the 6th century BC, Israel had gone into exile in Babylon, and they maintained that the reason they went into captivity, there was truth in what they said, was because they had forsaken the Torah, or the law of God. And therefore they saw the great need of the nation was to underline the law, to explain it, to apply it, and to make God's people aware of their duty, and a duty that must be faithfully performed. Sadly, they became very legalistic, and they began to imply in their teaching that following the law was the all-important thing. And therefore, men by obedience could win the favor of God, and ultimately the prize of heaven itself. So they started to emphasize the law and went too far with it, and saw obedience to the law as the condition of eternal life. Now we notice what our Lord says of this Pharisee. I don't want to dwell on what is said, but rather upon one particular statement tonight. But we'll try to set the scene. We read of the Pharisee that he stood in verse 11. Now, there's nothing wrong with standing in prayer. We believe that's a posture of which God approves in his word. The Greek, however, here carries a little more than the idea of simply standing in the temple precincts. It's literally, he stationed himself. And that brings out the underlying thought. Perhaps he occupied a very prominent position so that he could be seen, a little elevated, so that all eyes would be upon him. And with the very way he conducted himself, he drew attention to himself. Well, he stationed himself. This didn't bode well. It suggested at once that he was playing a part. And then we read that this man prayed thus with himself. God, who heard his prayer, declared that there was nothing spiritual about it. His prayer did not arise from his heart, and it did not ascend to the throne of God. He was really talking to himself, because his prayer was unacceptable from beginning to end. And God had made it clear in Scripture that such a prayer as this is never heard. So he had no contact with God, no dealing with God, no communion with God. He was speaking words, but he was not praying. He was in the temple, but he was not in the presence of God. He had people near him, observing him, but he did not have the Lord anywhere near him or taking account of him. He prayed thus with himself. And thirdly, we notice what he says in his prayer. Here it is, I thank thee. Do you see what's missing? There is no recognition here of fault. No acknowledgement of wrongdoing. He's very full of himself, but he knows nothing of what Christ described when he said, blessed are the poor in spirit. He's not poor in spirit. He's not humble. He's not recognizing his need. We would say that he's full of himself. He thinks he's a really good chap. And if anybody's prayer is going to be heard and answered by the God above, it's going to be his. Because after all, he's not like other men are. I notice that he's familiar with God. God, he says, and right into prayer. No preparation of heart. No declaration of the otherness of God. He talks to God as a man would talk to a neighbor. No fear of God in the man, but also a great emphasis upon himself. Notice how many times I appears. I thank thee that I am not as other men. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. He's supposed to be approaching God, but he's so full of himself. So full of himself. So what is this Pharisee's religion? Are we given some insight into it here? Yes, I think we are. what he mentions as he prays or thinks he prays is all outward performance. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. So it's his works which he is mentioning before God. That is his appeal to God. We can't escape the feeling that he's bringing this to God. See what I've done, Lord, in my fasting and in my tithing. That's the basis on which he makes his approach. He's relying upon his works. And he's a man who hopes for salvation through works. Just like the Judaizers in Galatia. Believing a gospel of faith, God, but faith mingled with meritorious work. I thank thee that I'm not as other men are. In fact, if we had time to look more closely at these words, he goes beyond what the Word of God actually requires. I fast twice in the week. There was only one fast prescribed in the Old Testament, and that was in Leviticus 23 in verse 27, connected with the Day of Atonement, a day of fasting, a day to afflict one's soul. And that fast day was to be on the 10th day of the 7th month. That was all God asked. But he says, I fast twice in the week. So my merit or my deserving is over and above mere obedience. I excel. I give tithes of all that I possess. In the Old Testament, God said that only certain things had to be tithed. He went further. He tithed everything so that there was a surplus of good, you see. He did more than God required, more than God demanded of him. He was righteous. Well, that's hardly the right word. He's super righteous. And therefore, he'll have no problem drawing near to God, surely. And if anybody's going to be saved, it's going to be him, surely. He's streets above others. He's made better progress than most men. He's certainly far in advance of this chap, just a few yards from him, this publican who takes upon himself to pray to God. So that's the Pharisee, a man who emphasizes works. He's got his like today, hasn't he, in those who think that Christianity is all about doing good things, keeping the law. And if you do that, well, you don't need what the Bible calls conversion. You don't need to be forgiven. You don't need to believe in Christ and receive him. Your works surely will tip the balance. Your works will pass the test for you and make sure that you're welcomed into heaven. A lot of people who think that. Well, enough of the Pharisee. Look now at the publican. Who was this publican? Well, we would call him today a tax collector. That's what the word means. It's not used in the modern sense of the owner of an inn or one who serves in such an establishment. No, the publican of the New Testament was nothing more or less than a tax collector. It was the way of the Roman authorities that they looked to the aristocracy among the Jews, the important people, to collect taxes for the Roman Empire. And these aristocrats, or the upper class, as they were known as, they farmed out these duties to less honorable men. And it was an arrangement which was accepted on both sides, that if men of the baser sort wanted to overcharge the Jews in their taxing, well, they were at liberty to do so, providing they got what Rome demanded of the people, the amount that was required of each Jew. Then the superiors were happy with that. And if they overcharged, then they could put the surplus in their pockets, which these unscrupulous men did. And so we have in the case of Zacchaeus, a tax collector, a publican, who obviously was making a lot of money out of his particular line of things. He was overcharging. He gave Rome her dues, but he made a nice little bit on the side. And he was quite content. And only when he was converted did Zacchaeus turn from this practice and say that if he'd robbed anyone, then he would surely give it all back to them, and manyfold more than he'd taken, to show that he was sorry for what he'd done, that he was truly repentant. Well, this man, he draws near too. And verse 13 says, standing afar off. That's the first thing that we are told of him, that there was a reluctance in him to come into close contact with God. Why was that? I think he felt shame. He knew what he'd done in fiddling the figures. He knew what he'd done in stealing from the oppressed, in being greedy of filthy lucre. He knew what he'd done. He knew the sort of man he was. He knew the covetousness of his own heart. He knew that he was mercenary in spirit. And therefore, when he came into the presence of a holy God, he felt no longer at ease. He didn't think that it was right for him to be there. He didn't think that he could honestly move into God's presence. He reminds me at this point of Peter. In Luke 5, after one of the early miracles of Christ, Peter recognized who Christ was, that he was divine. And this is what Peter said, "Depart from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." He didn't feel that he had any right to be near the one who was holy and heavenly. Well, this man thinks the same. He's ashamed of his sin. His guilt makes him feel, I have no right to get close. Indeed, such is the sin that I have committed, that God could destroy me justly and righteously. So he stood afar off in recognition of his sin. And then we read that he would not so much as lift up his eyes into heaven. The Jewish way of praying was often to lift up the eyes to the world above, where the invisible God was enthroned. He couldn't do that. He put his head down. He was like a bulrush that was bruised. He couldn't look up. You know why? Because the man was bearing a burden of guilt. And his sins were so many and so fearful that they weighed him down. And he was brought low on account of his sins. Then something very significant. He smote upon his breast, on his heart, taking his fist, as it were, and beating his chest. It was a highly significant action. He was really saying, I'm a wretched, wretched man, and the trouble is not in society, and it's not in other people. The trouble is there. It's in my wicked heart. That's the source of all my sin. And I give no excuse for it. I am certainly not proud of it. Oh, wretched man that I am. He beats solemnly upon his breast. For several moments, that's all you can hear. The man thumping his chest as if confessing the wickedness of his heart. The heart, the Bible says, is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. You see, we sin not because we learn it from others. We sin not simply because we choose that as a way of life. We sin because we are sinners. We were born in sin, and in sin did our mothers conceive us. We are by nature sinners. And in these moments, nothing is said. Certainly he doesn't say as much as the Pharisee said. The list of all his virtues, the list of all his good works, all his achievements. No, no. Nothing of that at all, because you see, he feels he has nothing of that nature to declare. He feels sinful, he feels wretched. What he does say is significant. He says, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. That is highly revealing. He doesn't appeal to God's justice and say, because I've lived so well, Lord, it's only right that you give me access to your presence. It's only right that you show me favor. It's only right that at the last you open the kingdom of heaven to me. No, no. He doesn't plead for justice, because he knows that if he pleads for justice, then in a moment he would perish. for his sins deserve eternal death. So he pleads for mercy, which is God's pity to those that are miserable, to those that are needy, to those that are poor. That's what he needs, the pity of God. It's not quite the fair show, is it, of the Pharisee? And yet Jesus said that this publican, when he turned from the temple and went to his home, he went right with God, in a right standing with God, forgiven and accepted by God, justified. Whereas the Pharisee, he left the temple a condemned man. The publican left a pardoned man. Well, you will understand that the most important words in the parable are those found at the end of verse 13. The publican's prayer. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Now, if there is a main thrust to the parable, it's here. This is what Christ, the great teacher, would impress on us and leave with us. The publican's prayer. In that prayer, we shall see the reason why he was received, why his prayer was answered, and why he was made right with God. Now, looking at it tonight, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I want us to work backwards. We'll all become Hebrews. Hebrew is read backwards, so we'll read the text backwards. And we'll begin with sinners. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Then we'll work further back to mercy. Be merciful to me. And then further back to God. So we begin at the end. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Sinners, then. Now, what does he understand by that? What is intended by that? Sin is breaking God's law. That's what sin is. John defines it for us in 1 John 3:4. He says, sin is the transgression of the law. Paul turns it around in Romans chapter 4 and verse 15, and he says, where no law is, there is no sin. Because sin is breaking the law. There has to be a law in place. And then man has to transgress that law for sin to be or to appear to be. And it shows us the nature of sin. God's law, summarized in the days of Moses in the 10 words or the 10 commandments, They weren't counsels, they were declarations. This, God says, is how you should live. So it's a divine law. To break it is all the more serious, therefore. It is an authoritative law. It is pronounced, thou shalt not. All the power of heaven is behind those enactments. And it's a holy law. The law is holy and just and good. Who would want to break such a law? Sinners would. And sinners would for a reason, and the publican confesses that he's one of them, because sinners in their hearts are rebels. We excuse sin and we treat it far too lightly, but sin is an act of revolt. By sin, men show their antipathy to God and to God's will, and chiefly to God's law. And like a rebel, the sinner says, who is God that I should obey him? But why don't you want to obey God? The answer is because my carnal heart is at enmity with God. I am at variance with God. Romans chapter 8 and verse 7. I have a dislike of God. I have in my heart a refusal to follow what he says, because I am a rebel. When Samuel addressed Saul, king of Israel, after one notable act of disobedience, Samuel says to him, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. He names it for what it is. You were told to do something, you refused to do it, Saul, and that constitutes you a rebel before God. In your heart, you are a rebel, for out of the heart proceed all evil. In your life, you are a rebel, for you sin against God. Does it matter? Oh, yes, it matters. As in days of old, if a man was found to be a traitor, if the King of England discovered his treachery and his great wickedness in plotting perhaps against the king's life, but certainly defying the king's will, then the supreme penalty would be brought upon that man. Rebels were consigned to the Tower, ultimately to the block. They were executed. And God has rebels. And God has said that if a man offend in one point, even if it seems to be a minor act of treason, a minor act of rebellion, he is guilty. Guilty of law breaking and subject to the penalty of death itself. The wages of sin is death. To know nothing of life with God, to know nothing of the happy life of the blessed, to know nothing of the life which people enjoy in heaven. Contrary to that, the sinner dies. Excluded. Condemned. But doesn't the law offer a hope to such a man? No. The law makes no provision for disobedience. The law of God offers no remedy for treason. Simply to declare that sin, whatever be its nature, whether it be great or small, sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. Now this publican, he's not blind to the state of his heart, and he's not blind either to the sin of his life. I am a sinner. The Greek has the definite article in God be merciful to me, the sinner. Almost as if, say some, he thinks of himself as the greatest of sinners. Sinners of whom Paul said later in one of his epistles, I am chief. I acknowledge one truth, O God, that I am a great sinner. Have you ever come to terms with that? We're all brought up to pride ourselves in our plumage and to think what pretty birds we all are. A lovely sight. I'm a good person, really. There's a lot of things about me that are attractive. There's nothing about the sinner that's attractive. Nothing. And the publican knew it. What am I? I tell you what I am. It sums up all that I am. A sinner. Well, to reach that point is quite vital. Absolutely essential. You've got to know your problem before you can inquire after the solution. To recognize your illness before you seek the remedy. I am a sinner. Sinners. Then move back. Mercy. God be merciful to me, a sinner. Now, mercy is a peculiar excellence in God. It's one of his chief perfections. And that is why the Bible says that God to Moses spoke these words, I will show thee my glory. And there in Exodus 34, God passed before him and proclaimed who he was, a God merciful and gracious, pardoning iniquity and transgression and sin. God says, it's my glory. The distinguishing feature about me, the greatest excellence I possess, that I have mercy. Now, what is mercy? We use two words, and they're found often in Scripture. The one is grace, and the other is mercy. Now, they're different in this respect, that grace is the love of God shown to those who don't deserve it. Mercy is the love of God shown to those that are wretched and miserable. It's the inclination of the heart of God to relieve us of that which is true of us, that which is spoiling our life, that which will make our death terrible, that which will make judgment unbearable, that which will make eternity something unendurable. It's pity, it's compassion, it's love wanting to save. That is mercy. And mercy has no motive in us. God doesn't look upon us and say, ah, well, because of this and that and the other, I will exercise the prerogative of mercy. No, no. Mercy is free. In that God says, I will have mercy upon whom I will have mercy. So here is the sinner, troubled on account of his sin, desperately unwilling to die, because he knows that one day he's accountable for his sin. One day he will stand before the judge of all the earth and be indicted for his sin. He can't face that. He lives in fear of that and terror of that. And God looks down and his heart is moved. Oh, that this man could be forgiven and restored. But you know something? God cannot show mercy at the expense of his justice. So though his heart is inclined to relieve us of guilt and of punishment, God has got to act justly even in this matter. And he's done that. And it's really hidden in this text. God, have mercy to me, a sinner. The word mercy there, elasco, it means God be propitiated toward me. God in his mercy turn his anger away from me. But it's connected with something in the heart of the temple, the Ark of the Covenant. And the lid of that ark was known as the propitiatory. And it was there that the high priest sprinkled the blood of a lamb so that it was clear to all that any sinner approaching God must do so believing that his sin has been punished in a victim. Life has been demanded of another, and that is why God can turn and be merciful to the sinner. That's the word he uses. God be propitiated toward me. This publican is looking by faith into the heart of the temple, to that plate bearing the stain of the blood of a sacrificial lamb. And he's saying, show mercy, O God, upon that basis. I don't want mercy at the expense of justice. I want mercy with justice satisfied. And in Christ, that's what I've got. I've got mercy offered to me because another has died for the likes of me and has taken my place and has yielded his life and has shed his blood, and my sin has been paid for and judgment has fallen upon my sin, which he took unto himself, bearing the charge of it and the blame of it and the punishment of it. And on the basis that God has given me a substitute who has died in my stead, I seek mercy from God. Sinners, mercy. We're back at the beginning. God, have mercy, or God, be merciful to me, a sinner. God, my friends, is the only one who can forgive sin. That is, who can cancel the guilt of sin. That is, who makes it no longer necessary for you to answer for your sin. The sin was against him. He was the lawgiver. He is the judge. Only he can remit sin and declare that a person is no longer guilty, no longer obligated to judgment, no longer bound over to the infliction of the wrath of God in the second death. Our God is the God of forgivenesses, the God who can declare our freedom from the law and its sentence. Who is a pardoning God like thee? Or who has grace so rich and free? So this publican, I sense that he knew far more theology than the Pharisee. He came into the presence of God. He acknowledged what he was, a sinner. That was his repentance. He believed in the blood of sacrifice, as we must do. We must believe that Christ died for sinners. And there is the ground of our hope, faith. And on the basis of his acknowledging of sin and confessing it and seeking God's mercy for it, and on the basis of his view of the blood of atonement, that someone had died for him, that he might be free, that a sacrifice had been made on his behalf, he pleads for mercy. Repentance and faith. And God extended mercy to him. For he went down to his house, right with God. Oh, my dear friends, if you would be reconciled to God, if you would know what it is to be received by him and to have the hope of eternal life, you must do what the publican did. You must confess your sin. You must put your faith and trust in the blood of atonement. And you must cry to God in mercy to save your soul. Put away your prayers. And tonight, at the end of the day, make this your prayer. Come into God's presence and say, "Oh God, be merciful to me, a sinner." And you'll fall asleep tonight, right with God. And when you awake in the morning, you'll still be right with God. And however long you live, you will always be right with God. Amen. We'll conclude with prayer. Let us stand. O Lord, these are wonderful words which we read, words which touch the heart of God. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. So bless us under the preaching of the gospel tonight, that each of us will make this his prayer, that each of us may be justified and right with God forever. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.